Hello, welcome again to another teaching on how Satan will imitate the coming of Christ. And today we're going to talk on how he will enter the temple of God. And we'll say he's Jesus. And during this discussion or teaching, we're going to answer the questions, will there be a third temple? Number two, where will this temple be? Number three, who will defile the temple? Number four, will Satan bring it with him? Number five, will the true witnesses be here before or after the arrival of the Antichrist? Number six, what seat or throne will Satan sit in? The one in heaven or the one on earth? And number seven, if Satan defiles the temple, it must be consecrated before he comes. In other words, he's got to sit in the holy temple. Well, then who will dedicate it or consecrate it before his arrival? Number eight, when will Satan defile the temple? So we will study, and we're going to start with the book of Lamentation, chapter 1. And I think that's a pretty good verse to start in. So we're going to get into God's Word. Let's pray first. Father, we ask in the name of Lord Jesus Christ, please be with us, Father. Give us wisdom. We ask wisdom from above, your wisdom. And Father, you open our eyes, open our ears, open our hearts to understand your Word. And we give you thanks for the Word that we're about to receive. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, your Son. Thank you, Father. Amen. Praise God. Lamentation chapter 1 and verse 8. Says, Jerusalem hath grievously sinned, therefore she is removed. All that honor her despise her, because they have seen her nakedness. Nakedness means nudity. Her grace, her disgrace, and her blemish. Yeah, she sigheth and turneth backwards. In other words, she looks back, she turns back. Or she, the Bible says there in the book of Luke, chapter 17, verse 32, remember Lot's wife? What did she do? She looked back. And like Jesus said there in the book of Luke, chapter 9, verse 62, no man having put his hand on the plow and looking back is worth or is fit for the kingdom of God. In other words, backsliding. But does God forgive backsliding? Yes. Hosea chapter 14, verse 4, says there in verse 9. Her filthiness is translated as tuma, which means her religious impurity, or yes, religious impurity, or actually her spiritual adultery. She's been slipping around, maybe jumping in bed with Satan. Her filthiness is in her skirts. She remembereth not her last end. She don't even remember the last time or the last place she was at. She's been slipping around. She don't even remember the last time with what, or actually with who. It says she had no comfort. She don't remember her last end. Therefore, she came down wonderfully. She came down on great wonder. She had no comforter. O Lord, behold my affliction, behold my misery, or behold my tribulation. Or depression. For the enemy, who is the enemy? That's Satan. That's our adversary. The Matthew chapter 13, verse 39. He's our enemy. Has magnified himself. When will Satan, our enemy, magnify himself? When he will sit in the throne of God. Like it says there in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Like this says there in Daniel chapter 11, verse 36 and 37, that he will magnify himself above all gods. In other words, he will give himself the name that is above all gods, and that is the name of Jesus. It says, verse 10, the adversary. And who is the adversary? And who is the enemy? That's Satan. Remember 1 Peter 5, 8? The adversary will spread his hand upon all her pleasant things. Praise God. And it says, for she has seen that the heathen entered into her sanctuary. Heathen is translated as goy. The word goy is an interesting word, which actually could mean a foreign nation, or as it, or it could mean a Gentile, or it also could mean a troop of animals or a flight of locusts. That's interesting, praise God. A flight of locusts, because Satan will come with his locust, with the locust army. She has seen that the heathen entered into her sanctuary. And during this study, I want you to pay attention to the word heathen and the word sanctuary. The word sanctuary in the Old Testament, or the Hebrew, it either uses the Strong's number 4720, which is the word mikdash, which means a consecrated place or thing, or it uses the Hebrew word 6944, which is kodesh, which means a sacred place or thing. So, for she has seen that the heathen entered into her sanctuary, into her sacred place or thing, or the sacred place, that's the temple, whom thou didst command that they should not enter into thy congregation. God commanded that they should enter into the congregation. That's why Satan will be the abomination of desolation, spoken by Daniel the prophet. That's why Jesus said, when you see, praise God, the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, praise God, for he ought not. I know it says it not, but it's a, you know, it's a transitive verb, and since we're talking about Satan, he's an entity, it should have been translated as the Moffat Bible translated, when you see the abomination of desolation standing where he ought not. It says right here, they should not enter in thy congregation. Well, God also ordered them in Psalms 105, verse 15, not to touch my anointed and do my prophets no harm. Which will bring me to Psalms. Let's go to the book of Psalms, chapter 79. Praise God. Psalms chapter 79. And it says here in Psalm 79, verse 1. It says, O God, the heathen. There's that word again, goy, which means a foreign nation or Gentile, or it also means a troop of animals or a flight of locusts. O God, the heathen are coming to thy inheritance, thy holy, and there's the word kodash, praise God, thy holy temple. See, when Satan comes, the temple has to be holy. It says, the heathen are coming to thine inheritance, thy holy temple. And temple here, a lot of people will say, well, this can't be talking about a temple, you know, a literal temple. Well, the Hebrew word is hekal. And the Hebrew word hekal means, it's the Strong's number 1964, and it means a large public building, such as a palace or a temple. So is Satan gonna sit in a literal temple? Yes, it's a large building, praise God. It is a literal temple. Well, this must be talking about Nebuchadnezzar. Well, let's see. Let's see what time this Psalm 79, verse 1 through 3 is talking about. It says, thine inheritance, thy holy temple, have they defiled, praise God. They have laid Jerusalem on heaps. Where is the temple going to be? Jerusalem. Verse 2. The dead bodies of thy servants have they given to be meat unto the fowls of heaven. That means the two witnesses. The body of the two witnesses. The dead body of thy servants have they given to be meat unto the fowls of the heaven. The flesh of thy saints unto the beast of the earth. And here is interesting, because we can see actually Satan also trying to imitate the coming of Christ. Which part is he going to imitate? Well, here in the book of Revelation chapter 19, verse 17, it says, and I saw an angel, and this is talking about the coming of Jesus, and I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings and flesh of captains and flesh of mighty men and the flesh of horses and of them that sit on them and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. So Satan will imitate this. Praise God. But let's go back. That's a different story. I mean, that's a different study for a different time. So let's get back to the two witnesses. It says, the dead bodies of thy servants have been given them to meat unto the fowls of heaven. the flesh of the saints, that's the two witnesses, unto the beast of the earth. Verse 3. Their blood have they shed like water round about Jerusalem, and there was none to bury them. Let's compare this to Revelation chapter 11 and verse 8 and 9. Talking about the two witnesses, it says, and their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt. Where's that at? Where is this? Where also our Lord was crucified. Where was the Lord crucified? In Jerusalem. What did it say over here? Praise God. Their blood have they shed like round about Jerusalem. And look at verse 9. It says, and they of the people and the kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves. And over here in Psalm 79 it says, and there was none to bury them. You see, it's no doubt. Praise God. It doesn't put any shadow of a doubt that it's talking about the same time. Praise God. The time when the two witnesses are here. So it gives you a time frame. When will Satan sit in the temple? Well, during the time of the two witnesses. And of course, if he sits in the holy temple, that means that before Satan sits there, it must be consecrated or holy before he sits there. But doesn't 2 Thessalonians say that he will sit in the temple of God? And doesn't the Bible say there in Matthew 24, verse 15, the abomination of desolation sitting in the holy place or standing in the holy place? Praise God. It says right here, let's go back to verse 1 in Revelation 11. 1, let's pick up the subject here in Revelation 11, 1. It says, there was given me a reed like unto a rod. And the word rod is the Greek word rhabdos, which means a wand or a stick. And it comes from the Greek word ripo, which means to let fall or to smite or slap. Meaning that, yes, you measure the temple, but it is measured to be destroyed. Not for edification, but destruction. Why? Because the temple will be given into the hand of the enemy. Praise God. Let me read this verse from Lamentation chapter 2, verse 7. It says, Lord, the Lord has cast off his altar. He hath abhorred his sanctuary. Why? Why did he abhor his sanctuary? Why is it measured for destruction? He hath given it up into the hand of the enemy. And who is the enemy? And the word sanctuary here, of course, means consecrated place or holy place. His sanctuary, his holy place. He has given it up unto the hand of the enemy, that's Satan, the walls of our palaces. And remember here in Lamentation 4:12, it says, the kings of the whole earth and all the inhabitants of the world would not believe that the adversary of the enemy should have entered the gates of Jerusalem. Nobody believes it, that it's Satan, the Antichrist, that's going to enter into the gates of Jerusalem. Let's go back. It says, and there was given me a reed like unto a rod, Revelation 11:1. A rod, and the angel stood saying, rise and measure the temple of God. It's called the temple of God. And as we read there in Psalm 79, it's an actual temple, a literal temple, a large building. Praise God. Yes, and it is the same Greek word naos, which was used there in John 2:19. You know, but the Greek word here, it means to dwell. But also remember 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, that we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19, and 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. Yes, we're the temple of the Holy Spirit, but here in Revelation 11, it's talking about a literal temple. You know, praise God, in history, you know, Isaac Newton was one of the smartest scientists that ever lived. And he was pretty good. I mean, he would study the book of Revelation. And he believed that there was actually going to be a third temple. And not only that, I got my companion Bible here. It's pretty old. And I'm going to read from it. I hardly ever, you know, like to use it for. But it's as a second witness. You know, Bullinger, E.W. Bullinger was one of the greatest scholars that ever lived. And I don't believe everything he says. But praise God, you know, he can back up what he says, though. Look at Revelation chapter 11, and I'm going to read here from his notes. It says, all these particulars refer to an actual temple. The church of God knows nothing of an altar here, of naos. of a court of the Gentiles all point to the temple yet to be built in the holy city, Jerusalem. This temple will be on earth. See, so even Bullinger believed that it was going to be an actual temple, the third temple that is still yet to be built in Jerusalem. It says, rise and measure the temple of God and the altar and them that worship therein. So it actually is going to have an altar and people are going to worship therein. Praise God. And of course, before Satan defiles it. Praise God. So it says right here in verse 2. It says, but the court, which is outside the temple, or without the temple means outside, but the court that is outside, the word court is the word, the Greek word ole, which means, praise God, it means the yard as out there in the air. It also means court, patio, if you want to call it, but it could also mean palace. And of course, this was the, to me, I believe this is the palatial tent that is written there in Daniel chapter 11, verse 45, the tabernacle that Satan will set up, praise God, when he comes. So he actually doesn't bring the temple, he actually brings a palatial tent. It says, but the court, which is without, that's his palatial tent, that's outside the temple, leave out and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles. And the holy city, Jerusalem, shall they tread underfoot 42 months. And of course, 42 months is given in months, is the time of Satan. The time of Satan being here, right? Remember Revelation 13, it was given unto him to reign 42 months. That's 3.5 years, in which we know that it's cut short in the book of Revelation, chapter 9, verse 4. And praise God, praise God, in Revelation chapter 9, verse 5, I think. Yeah, Revelation 9, 5. Sorry about that. It says, and I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days. Yes, that's also 3.5 years. But notice how God used months for Satan and days for the sons of light. Praise God. And it says, clothed in sackcloth. Praise God. And who are these two witnesses? This is what verse 4 says. These are the two olive trees, you know, spoken in Zechariah chapter 4. And the two candlesticks standing before God of the earth. Praise God. And there's a different speculation who the two witnesses are. But we know that by the book of Malachi chapter 4 verse 6 that Elijah will come before the coming to prepare the way of the Lord. And a lot of people said, oh, well, that was John the Baptist. Well, remember the book of John chapter 1 verse 21 that they asked John the Baptist, are you Elijah? Are you that prophet? And John the Baptist answered, no. So you think John the Baptist was lying? No, Elijah is yet to come. So we know that one of those two witnesses is Elijah. Praise God. And who is the second witness? Well, a lot of people believe it is Moses, which is probably your number one candidate. You know, I don't know. This is my opinion. To me, if you will ask me, what's my personal opinion? I believe it's Enoch. After reading the book of Enoch, praise God, which was written for God's elect that would be here during the time of tribulation. Praise God. And he was a great prophet. It says, I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. Praise God. Verse 4, these are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before God of the earth. Verse 5, oh, praise God. Let me back a little bit. You know, the Bible says here that he would stand in the temple of God. It calls it the temple. It must be God's. And he will stand in the holy place. So it has to be holy. And the sanctuary means a consecrated place or sacred place. So it, before Satan enters, it has to be consecrated. And who will be alive during that time to consecrate the temple? Well, I guarantee you that there will not be anybody more qualified than the two witnesses to consecrate it to God. So yes, I believe that the two witnesses will be here a little bit before the coming of the Antichrist. Praise God. And of course, praise God, that is my educated guess. And praise God, by reading this, and verse 5 says, and if any man will hurt them, well, let me give you some scripture for that. The book of Isaiah chapter 63, verse 18. Book of Isaiah, chapter 63, verse 18. And it says there, the people of thy holiness have possessed it for a little while. Yes, they will possess it for a little while. Then Satan will come and defile it. Praise God. It says, our adversaries have trodden it down, thy sanctuary, thy holy place, thy consecrated place, the temple. And who? Our adversaries. That's Satan and his army, Satan and the locust army, Satan and his angels. Verse 19, we are thine. We are thine, Lord. Thou never bearest rule over them. They were not called by thy name. They were never called by thy name. Who are these? Well, it has to be angels, the offspring of the angels, meaning the Cainites, or maybe even the spirit of the Nephilim, or the, praise God, you know, the offspring of the angels themselves. Yeah, they will possess it for a little bit, praise God, but then, you know, Jesus Christ comes. And for a little while, the Bible says there, Satan comes having great wrath because he knows he has but what? A short space. Verse 5 says, that if any man will hurt these two witnesses, fire proceeded out of their mouth and devoured their enemies. Remember, the word of God is like a fire. Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 29. It says, and if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. But remember what Jesus said, what God said in the book of Psalm 105, verse 15, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. These have power to shut up heaven as that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, like Elijah, and have power of the waters to turn them into blood and smite the earth with all plagues like Moses, praise God. But remember, book of Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 5 and 6, that Moses did die, praise God. I know a lot of people want to believe that he was translated, that he never saw, but the Bible does say he died. You got to consider that. And Enoch never died, and nor Elijah. They were transformed or translated. Praise God. And it says, to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. In other words, they have supernatural powers. In other words, these are not natural men. These are supernatural. In other words, they come from heaven. Verse 7, they're endowed with the power of God. Verse 7 says, and when they shall have finished their testimony, the beast that ascended out of the bottomless pit. Where does this beast come from? Well, he's the angel of the bottomless pit. He's an angel. Praise God. He's the angel of the bottomless pit, says there in Revelation chapter 9, verse 11. Not only that, since he's the angel and the king, of course he has the, praise God, he has the keys of the bottomless pit. And he's the king of the bottomless pit. Why? Because have you ever seen, praise God, a king rule when he's in jail or locked up? No, he has power to roam up and down the earth, in heaven and earth, right? Praise God. Please watch my video. Praise God, Satan shall come from heaven, the beast that ascended out of the bottomless pit. It says, shall make war against them, shall overcome them and kill them. He actually going to do something that God commanded him not to do. Verse 8, and their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which is spiritually called Sodom, and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified, Jerusalem. That's where Satan sets camp. And I call it camp because that's where he sets his tabernacle, the palatial tent. And verse 9, and they of the people and the kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half. How long? 3 days and a half. And should not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves, as it is written there in Psalm 79, verse 3. There was none to bury them, right? Praise God. Why? Well, God or Satan is Satan's imitating Christ, and he's trying to say that, you know, these witnesses there, praise God, these prophets are false prophets, and I'm gonna show you, I'm gonna document you that they're not going anywhere because I'm God. That's what he's gonna be saying. And verse 10 says, and they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them, make merry and shall send gifts one to another, because these two prophets tormented them that dwell on the earth with what? With the word of God and with their power from God, praise God. And you got to understand that mainstream religion teaches that the dragon, the false prophet, and the beast are three entities. Praise God. Actually, they believe that the false prophet is somebody else and the beast is somebody else. Praise God. But you can see in Revelation chapter 13, verse 11 through 14, who's the one doing the miracles there? Well, you know right there that it's, praise God, that the one doing the miracles is, of course, the beast. And over here in Revelation chapter 19, verse 20, you can see that it is the, praise God, the false prophet doing the miracles. So who is it? Who's the one doing the miracles? The false prophet or the beast? Is the Bible lying? Or is the false beast and the prophet one and the same? You have to come to the conclusion that the false prophet and the beast are the same entity, one person, the dragon Satan. Praise God. Oh, Señor. And of course, you know, the main belief is that there's going to be a false prophet and a beast. So I'm pretty sure when Satan comes saying that he's Jesus, what is he going to say these two witnesses are? The beast and the false prophet, that he, you know, praise God, delivered judgment upon them. And it says, and they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry and shall send gifts one to another because these two prophets tormented them that dwell on the earth. Verse 11. And after 3 days and a half, how long? Praise God. How long are the three witnesses going to be slain? You see, God gives us a time frame right here. Praise God. We don't know the day nor the hour, but we do know the season. And we know that after 3 days and a half, praise God, that the two witnesses are slain. This is what happened. It says here. And after 3 days and a half, the spirit, that's the pneuma, means the breath of life from God, entered into them. And they stood upon their feet. And, you know, remember 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Praise God. And great fear fell upon them which saw them. And you know what? You know, we're going to be transformed at the final trump. But Elijah and praise God, and Enoch or Moses, praise God, whichever one you believe or think, praise God, they already have transformed bodies. Praise God. They already come from God. So they're not going to be transformed. Actually, they're going to rise. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Verse 12, and they heard a great voice, and that's the seventh trump, from heaven saying unto them, come up hither. And they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them. Remember in a cloud, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17, praise God, it says that we shall be caught up in the clouds, in the gathering, praise God, the cloud or the gathering, praise God, the great cloud, the great multitude, to meet the Lord in the air, and there in the air, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17, is not atmosphere. The word air there is a Greek word 109, meaning aer, which means the breath. Like, praise God, the breath of what? The breath of life. In other words, we're going to be caught up in, or pulled by force into the cloud, into that great multitude, that gathering, to meet the Lord in the air, in the spirit, in the breath, and the breath of life, body. Oh, Señor. In other words, we're going to be transformed. And they heard a great voice from heaven saying unto them, come up hither. And they ascended up to heaven in the cloud, and their enemies beheld them. Praise God. Listen, y'all. You know, so God gives us a time right here, a season that we to look forward to. Praise God. Listen, y'all. And exactly the Lord at the final trump, right? First Corinthians chapter 15, verse 52. Let's turn our Bibles there to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we're talking about how Satan will enter the temple of God. Listen, I hope you're enjoying this, right? Enjoying this video. I studied a lot. Let's see, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. It says, now we beseech you, brethren, in other words, the request or inquire, now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto Him. That's the gathering. That's the cloud. That's when we're going to be gathered to God. At the coming. The coming is the gathering. Praise God. Well, a lot of people refer to the gathering as, you know, they want to refer to rapture. Was not in the Bible. Which the word rapture, the origin of it, look it up. It comes from the Greek, it comes from the Latin word raptura, which means to rape or to seize, praise God, or to kidnap. In no way is the word raptura compared to harpazo in the Greek, which means pulled by force, praise God. It says, coming, we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him. You want to call it rapture or harvest? Some people call it a harvest. Yes, the harvest. What is the harvest? The harvest is at the end of the world. For Matthew 13:39. It doesn't say 7 years before the end. Praise God for the tribulation. No, it says, it's the end of this world age. Matthew 13:39. Praise God. Together unto him. Verse 2. That you be not soon shaken in mind, nor be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as of the day of Christ is at hand. You know, the day of, you know, you got kind of confused in that first letter. Well, I'm right here to set the order straight. Praise God, how it really is going to transpire. It says, that you be not shaken in mind, nor be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor as for letter, as from us, as the day of Christ is at hand. And the Greek word, as at hand, means in a stemi, which means in a moment. Yes, the coming of the Lord will be in a moment. When? At the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. At the last trump. Yes, praise God. The day of the Lord will come. It says right here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 2, for you yourselves know perfectly well that the day of the Lord, it doesn't say the rapture of the Lord, it says the day of the Lord, the second coming of the Lord, so cometh as a thief in the night. What cometh as a thief in the night? The rapture? No. It says the day of the Lord. How many times is the Lord going to come? Just one more time. Praise God. Look at verse 4. It says, but you, brethren, are not in darkness. 1 Thessalonians 5:4 says, for you, brethren, are not in darkness that the day should overtake you as a thief. See, if we're not in darkness, the day is not going to take us as a thief. Why? Because we know when those two witnesses are slain. Well, how many days after that? Praise God. 3 days and a half. And not only that, praise God, glory Señor, it's not going to catch us as a thief. Praise God, because we know that the one that's in the temple of God saying that he's God is Satan. Praise God. Let no man deceive you by any means, it says right here, praise God. Let no man deceive you by any means. Don't let nobody, not this man, any other man. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day, in other words, our gathering, the second coming, the coming of the Lord, shall not, our gathering, that day shall not come except what? There come a falling away first. The Greek word here, falling, means the falling away is apostasia. What does apostasia mean? It means, praise God, defection from the truth. And in no way does it use the word departure. A lot of people want to put the word departure, meaning the departure of this earth. But in no way is it departure from this earth. Departure from the truth, maybe. Praise God, defection, yes. But not the word, actually the word. If it wanted to put the word departure, it would have used the Greek word anoulousis. He didn't use the word anoulousis. He used the word apostasia, which means the departure from the truth, defection from the truth. Praise God. Listen, it doesn't matter how bad you want it to say departure. It doesn't say departure. Praise God. There come a falling away first. That has to happen first before the Lord comes. And the man of sin be revealed. What else has to have to happen before Jesus comes? The man of sin be revealed. Right now, a lot of people are guessing who the man of sin is. Oh, he's this, he's the Pope, the President, or some European guy, or some. No, they're just guessing. That's not being revealed. Praise God. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called, it says, praise God, they're falling away first, and that the man of sin be revealed. And who's this man of sin? Well, who's the one that invented sin? Who was the first one to sin? Praise God. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 8, he that continues sinning, or he that sinneth, or continues sinning, is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. Praise God. He's the one that invented. Nobody else deserves that title more than Satan. Praise God. Unless you can find somebody that sins worse than Satan. Praise God. It says, be revealed. Not guess that. Revealed. There in the temple. Praise God. The man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. And of course, the Greek word perdition means ruin the laws. And who's the one that's already ruined the laws? Praise God, that is Satan. He's already judged. John chapter 16, verse 11, of judgment. Because the prince of this world is judged. And of course, perdition, it comes from the word apolami, which comes from the word apolia, which comes from the word apolion, which means destroy, the destroyer, Satan. Praise God. I think it's Strong's 623. Praise God. For Apollyon. The son of perdition, verse 4. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God, as Jesus, praise God, as El, remember Ezekiel 28, 2 and 6 and 9 from last lecture, calls himself El, calls himself the Almighty, calls himself Jesus, because who's the Almighty? Revelation 1, 8, that's Jesus. Exalt himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing off, actually the Greek word is, himself that he's God. How is he going to show off that he's God? By performing miracles. Praise God. Blessing you. Let's go to the book of Ezekiel 28. And I know we covered this, but I want to read it again. Praise God, just for emphasis, for praise God, documentation, in case nobody has... In case you didn't watch the last video, Ezekiel 28, verse, I'm just going to read it. Ezekiel 28, verse 1. Please watch the last video. I'll go into depth on this one. Ezekiel 28, verse 1. It says, the word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus. That's the prince that shall come. Like in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, Tyrus means rock, but this one is the fake rock. Thus says the Lord God, because thine heart is lifted up, is exalted, like we just read there in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4, exalting himself above all that is called God, you know, or Daniel chapter 11, verse 36 and 37, exalting himself above every God, giving himself the name of Jesus. Thou hast said, I am a God, I am El, the Almighty. Praise God. And who's the Almighty? That's Jesus. What is he going to say? That he is God, that he's Jesus. I sit in the seat of God. And let me ask you a question. Where did he sit in the seat of God? Did he actually sit in the seat of God in heaven? You think God allowed that? No. He's going to sit in the seat of God. Where? In the temple of God, the abomination of desolation, standing where he ought not. Praise God. In the seat of God, in the midst of the season, where is that at? Well, read Revelation, I mean Daniel 11, verse 45, in the glorious land, in the midst of the seas, praise God. Yet thou art a man, that's Jerusalem. Where is he going to sit? In Jerusalem. Yet thou art a man, praise God. And remember, man was created in their image. We, praise God, angels were first called man. Remember Gabriel, what does Gabriel mean? Mighty man of God. And not God, thou set thine heart as the heart of God. He makes himself think or believe. He makes his heart, praise God, or pretend so much. Praise God. He's such of a good play actor that he actually going to believe that he's Jesus. He's going to set his heart as he is Jesus. Praise God. He's actually going to make himself be Jesus. Praise God. Verse 6. And let's look at verse 6. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because thou hast set thine heart as the heart of God. So he's going to try to be Jesus. And look at verse 9. Well, though in verse 8 says, they shall bring thee down to the pit, and thou shalt die the deaths of them that are slain in the midst of the seas. Will thou yet say before him that slay thee, I am God? You know, in other words, when Jesus comes, are you still going to be able to say you're God? Are you still going to be able to say you're Jesus? But thou shalt be a man and no God in the hand of him that slayeth thee. You're nothing but a man before God. And praise God. Let me read from Isaiah chapter 14. Praise God. Isaiah chapter 14. And I think we'll finish with this one for this video. And I might stay here to do the second video. I don't know yet. Praise God. It depends. Praise God. Isaiah chapter 14. And we'll read from verse 12. It says, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? What does Lucifer mean? It means Hillel. It means the morning star. And who's the true morning star? Revelation chapter 22, verse 16. Jesus. In other words, he calls himself Jesus. Praise God. Oh, Lucifer, son of the morning, son of the dawn. Praise God. You know, the people, the Luciferians, the Illuminati, if you want to call them or whatever. Praise God. You know how they refer to the coming of Satan? They call it the new dawn of the Illuminatium. With the I am at the end, Illuminatium, I am at the end. Why? Praise God. Well, the dawn, the son of the morning. Morning means dawn, son of the dawn. Praise God. Or aurora. How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations. Praise God. Verse 13. For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, above the angels of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation. Praise God. Where is he going to? Or allowed him to sit, because a lot of people say this happened a thousand years ago. You know, Satan sat in the throne. You think, you actually believe that Satan sat in the throne of God? Praise God. It never does the Bible say that he tried to sit in the temple of God. It says he will sit in the temple of God. It says, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of congregation in the sides of the north. And where is that at? The sides of the north. Let me read from you again from Psalm 42. Well, the Señor says, judge me. I mean, Psalm 48. Praise God. Sorry, forgive me. Psalm 48 says, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God in the mount of his holiness. Beautiful for situation. Verse 2. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth. Where? Earth. Is Mount Zion in the sides of the north, the city of the great God. So where is he going to sit? In heaven? No. On earth. So this, Isaiah 14:12, hasn't happened yet. Satan hasn't been kicked down. He kicked out yet. Yes, he was given limited access to heaven. He's to read Job 1, 6, and 7. Praise God. And who accuses us before our God? And before our God in heaven? Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. Satan. Praise God. It says, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. It says, I will be like the Most High. He will be like what? Like Jesus. He will try to be like the Most High. Praise God. He will try to be like Jesus. Praise God. We haven't finished this teaching yet, but I'm going to stop it right now because of the time. Praise God. And I'm probably going to continue doing this teaching. So, praise God. Thank you again. Praise God. Hope you watch the next video. And, praise God, let me see. We answered some of these questions, or we're going to still have to wait for the next video. Will there be a third temple? Yes. Actually, Psalm 79 says there will actually be a temple. Revelation chapter 11, verse 2. An actual temple with an altar that people worship in. And number 2, where will this temple be? Jerusalem. We read that in Psalm 79, Revelation 11, and praise God, and we Daniel 11, verse 45, praise God. Verse 3 says, who will defile the temple? Satan. Praise God, the enemy will defile it. Remember, we read that in Lamentations, and praise God, and well, you can read that in, praise God, the abomination of desolation, Matthew 24, verse 15, and we also read that there in the book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 4. I mean, question number 4. Will Satan bring it with him? No, he will not bring the temple. It's going to be actually existing on earth. Praise God. Yes, the holy people, as it says there in Isaiah 63, will possess it for a little while. Praise God. And as I believe, praise God, there nobody will be more qualified to consecrate it, to be able to be called holy to God more than the two witnesses. Praise God. Will Satan bring it with him? No, what he brings is a palatial tent. Remember Daniel 11, verse 45? The court that is to not be measured. And number 5, will the true witnesses be here before or after Satan's arrival? Well, praise God, if it's called a holy temple, praise God, and if it's a consecrated place, a sanctuary, well then, it has to be holy before Satan gets there. Of course it has to be holy. Praise God. And of course, I believe that, yes, the witnesses will be here a little bit before the arrival of the Antichrist. Number 6, praise God. Well, what seat or throne will Satan sit in? On the one in heaven or the one in earth? Of course, he would never be able to sit in the one on heaven, nor did he ever sit in the seat in heaven. It has to be the seat on earth. And number 7, if Satan defiles it, it must be consecrated before it comes. Who will dedicate or consecrate it? Praise God. Well, my belief is the two witnesses. Praise God. Number 8, when will Satan defile the temple? During the time of the two witnesses. We answered that in Psalm 79. And thank you, and God bless you, and I hope you get into God's Word, and when you get into God's Word, you make God's day. You know, praise God. He loves you. And expose Satan and his doctrine, praise God, you're kicking dragon, praise God. So continue kicking dragon, and I'll see you next time, and God bless. Thank you.